Okay, hello. Can you hear me now?
I can hear you. I can hear you. Anyway, so
Okay.
I heard something about trading. So what are you trying to trade there, buddy?
Already said I was trading a Grookey for a Pikachu.
For a Pikachu, is that a good trade? Because I have no freaking idea.
Yeah, because the Pikachu
Normally,
is a
no.
special. The Pikachu is a special Ash Hat Pikachu. He's wearing the same hat as Ash Ketchum wore in the X and Y season of the anime.
That almost sounds like a ripoff. Like, here's Pikachu, but with a hat.
It's a
Here's
cool hat.
Pikachu with a surfboard. Here's Pikachu. Like, there's like fucking 30 of them.
There's
There's
like
not a
the.
real. There's not an actual surfboard Pikachu in Pokemon, and there should be.
It's like,
Dude,
did
there
the.
is.
There is? Oh my god.
There's a
No, there
mini
definitely
game in
is.
Pokemon Yellow, but you can't get a surfboard Pikachu and use it in fights.
Yes, you can. Hang on. I think it was in Heart Gold Soul Silver. Surfboard Pikachu.
It's like the dudes that made Team Fortress 2 got a hold of Pokemon. I was like, I want to know how many hats you can actually put on the thing.
But anyway, here's a story about how life does not want me to exercise.
Oh, okay, good. No, lay it on us, brother.
Today, this beautiful Saturday morning, I decided, hey, I'm gonna go to my friend's house. And I went to my friend's house, and he didn't answer the door. And I was like, ah, that sucks. I'm just gonna go have a walk. You know what? I should get some exercise. Go walk around the Jasmine Lake, the nice lake, such a beautiful lake. I'm gonna go walk around it. It's gonna be great. And then, as I head down the road to go to the lake, I see there's like police caution tape. I don't even know what's happening. Like, I've not even investigated into this at all, but there was, I don't even know if it was caution tape, but it was some sort of tape blocking it off. And there was like a couple sheriff cars there, and there's some guys raking. I don't know why
Okay.
that was.
Do you think that they were just raking up the evidence of a recently dead body or just a recently discovered corpse or whatever?
That could be it. I don't know. I didn't go investigate any further.
Jesus, how bad is the neighborhood you live in, man?
Not that bad, but like, you know,
They
murders
set a
happen.
soap dispenser on fire.
Oh yeah, that's right. That's right. I forgot. You people and your crazy freaking antics. The antics. So damn. So that's a hell of a thing to walk around to fucking see.
Yeah, so I was just like, all right, fate doesn't want me to exercise. I'm just never gonna exercise again. Thanks, cops,
Now, are
for
you
giving me the
sure?
justification.
Now, are you sure that's justification or your rationale to talk yourself into not working out at all?
Yes.
My response to that is, shut up.
Oh, well, I don't work out either, so I don't really get to talk. I don't really get to talk. I can't really bitch at you for it.
I went to the gym once recently, but then 30 minutes in, my legs were chafed, so I stopped.
Man, the first time I went to the gym after like years of not going to the gym, I actually lasted a good hour and a half. It was all the other times I went to the gym where I was like, oh man, fuck this. Oh, this fucking sucks. Oh God, I can't
Yeah, the first
take
time I had went in a while was a month ago, and I did just fine that day, but it's recently.
Dude, Discord conspires against that poor kid. I fucking swear.
That was pretty good.
Oh my God, we're just gonna wait till he comes. All right, good. Here he is. All right, everyone, before you drop out, let's go ahead and just start the
One,
show.
a two, a skibbly dibbly doo.
That's my fucking intro. I look forward every week to doing this intro. And when people, it's like in my live streams, like if I'm playing with any of my friends, I'll go, all right, raid drop in three, and then they'll fucking jump on my shit. Like my friend, like I'll be like a one, a two, a skiddly doo doo, and like you son of a bitch.
Was it Joey?
Oh, it was. It's been Joey. It's been Paul. It's been fucking Die. It's been a bunch of people.
I've done it, haven't
You probably have, and I still
I?
need to yell at you probably for that. I'll yell at you after the show later on. Anyway, this is the MoCast. Welcome to the MoCast, everyone. I'm your host, Mo Diggity. Joining me today, as always, is my co-host, Robin. Say hi, Robin.
You forgot your little intro.
Well, y'all already did the intro for me. So this is the, you know what? This is the intro that we have now. This is the intro that we have.
This is the MoCast anymore. This is the Robin and Riley cast. Mo's the only one who didn't do the intro, so he gets left out.
Mo's well, lost it.
Oh, you sons of bitches. That's it. One, two, skiddly-dilly-do. Hey, everyone, how you doing? Welcome to the MoCast. I'm your host, Mo Diggity, the only one who does the intro for any of these freaking shows. And joining me today is our co-host, co-host numero uno, Robin. Say hi, Robin.
I can never do any wrong.
Good. And co-host numero fucking asshole is Riley. Say hi, Riley. Yeah, that's great. Anyway, today we're going to go ahead and talk about our... Oh, hi. Is that what you have to say?
Yeah, you said to say hi. That's why I said it.
Okay, then. Well, you go ahead and you just... cling on to your high. And this week we're going to talk about our favorite video games. What video games do we like? What consoles do we like them on? And what do we do with our lives besides play video games? Not a whole lot.
Nothing.
But you know, I like to think that all my time spent on World of Warcraft and Diablo 2 and Black Ops 2 and Resident Evil, I like to think that those that time has meant something and has led up to something good, you know? I think let's go ahead and start out with the game that we wasted with it. We probably played the most out of. I'll go ahead and start because it's fresh on my memory. I will go ahead and say it's probably World of Warcraft, and that that gives Diablo 2, another Blizzard game, a run for its freaking money, because I used to spend like days and weekends and weeks playing freaking Diablo 2, but then I got introduced to the addiction, the madness that was World of Warcraft. And ever since I played, I started off my very first main, it was a Fury Warrior. And ever since I started playing that warrior, man, I was hooked instantly. I've been late for work because of WoW. I have blew off a couple of parties and like a couple of going out for fun to socialize because of World of Warcraft. And I'm fine with it. I don't regret it at all, because if those parties were any fun, I would have gone to them. But you know, it's sort of like, well, you have nothing that interests me, and I've got to level my freaking Alliance Fury Warrior here. So yeah, Robin, What's a game you've blown the most time on? We'll start with you.
Well, I'm going to exclude League of Legends because that game is horrible and garbage.
It's garbage. MOBA sucks.
But probably technically the one I have the most hours in. But, and I can pull this up on Steam right now. Let me look. The game I've played the most, I know it is The Binding of Isaac. I have 1,007 hours in the original Flash version of The Binding of Isaac.
Holy
and then I have
shit.
651 hours in The Binding of Isaac Rebirth. And that's just on Steam. I own Rebirth on PlayStation 4 and 3DS.
Damn, so
you... The creator of Binding of Isaac came on my podcast and then shit on it on a live stream a couple months later.
Talking about Florian?
Or your podcast.
Yes.
Not Edmund, okay.
It was Florian, yes.
Florian didn't work on Rebirth at all.
I know, but Florian went on my video game show, and then like 10 weeks later on an Is It Kino Twitch stream, I asked him if he remembered, and he said no, and then I reminded him that he shit on my show because we read the news.
Damn. That's gotta fucking hurt, like, a whole lot.
Okay. Oh,
man. Dude, I couldn't freaking, like, I wouldn't be able to hold
it. It was all
my...
worth it because I got Monkey Jones to say the name of my podcast.
Oh, so you're just, you weren't really trying to, like, get him
clout
to remember
chasing.
Anything. You were just, yeah, you were just clout chasing, huh?
No, I wasn't clout chasing. He just said the name. I'm like, holy shit, I didn't even know this was a result of this chat.
Yeah, Riley,
I'm gonna go find that Twitch stream and clip him saying the name, and I'm gonna make, like, Gingy put it in the intro of every episode. It's just gonna become part of the intro now.
Oh, dear God, yes, that would be great. Man, Binding of Isaac is one of those games I never got to play, like Undertale. Like, I bought Undertale, like, about half a year after the madness surrounding Undertale really started hitting the mainstream. And I was like, all right, man, I'm looking forward to playing this game. I still haven't fucking played. Like, I played Papers, Please more than I've played Undertale. And I that's because I really, really like Papers, Please a lot. It's one of my favorite indie
games.
I've
never beaten Undertale, and I really should. I really should. I have it on my PS4. I've just never went and beaten it.
It's on the PlayStation?
Yes.
Yeah?
It's on Switch, too.
Oh, nice. No shit. Cool, cool, cool. Man, Binding of Isaac, though, I've seen a lot of live streams about that game, and everything about that game I really, really like. It reminds me of another game, I think it's called Gun Game, or something.
Enter the Gungeon.
Enter the Gungeon, there we go, there we go.
I know all of the roguelites.
Oh, see, I really like that genre of game. I've played a few roguelikes back in my day, but none of them has been, you know, sometimes they have problems keeping my...
Technically, it's not a roguelike, it's a roguelite, because there is progression.
Oh, Riri.
Yes.
Cool,
There's like... roguelikes, and then there's roguelites, and then there's like roguelike likes. There's like fucking a million different categories.
You know, everything's going to shit in the industry when you have like five different subsets of category of the same category.
It's just because I'm really into that type of game, so I know that there are a billion categories. Most people just call them roguelikes.
Cool, cool, cool. Yeah, there's
and nobody's ever played Rogue, really.
What would be considered rogue, though? Not
rogue. Rogue is the original game. That's all the games are called rogue likes because they're similar to rogue in the sense that they're like randomly generated, like massively replayable games.
Oh, nice, nice, nice. There goes Riley again. Man, the poor bastard. He keeps getting like knocked off. You know, that's something I wish I could just like. I wish I can grab a hold of the freaking people who've made this damn app and just scream at them, fix that shit, while I'm freaking shaking the shit out of them to actually fix the damn thing, because there's no excuse for this shoddy of a product, you know? Even though it's free, you figure that maybe, just maybe, it would be up to par, and everyone wouldn't have so many goddamn problems.
We had Skype, and that was just horrible.
See, I loved Google Hangouts. Google Hangouts was so great.
I liked it.
I've always had fun, never really had a problem with Google Hangouts at all. It's been all of these other ones, like you know, even freaking TeamSpeak, I think functioned much better than freaking Discord ever has. Even though you gotta like manually put in the address and all that, I don't mind doing that because I come from like the Perch 98 days, where you have to code in the address specific to the chat room that you're trying to get to, and connect manually from there. And if you forget what the address was, you're totally fucked, and you don't get to go back to that chat room. That's how
I'm a big fan of Zoom. Actually,
never heard of Zoom.
It's more for like video conferencing, like for like businesses and stuff, but it works really well for like formatting large video calls with people.
Nice, nice.
Back when I had a lot of friends.
It was back when I had a lot of friends too. It was when I was rocking Google Hangouts. Now I just
imagine having friends, can't relate.
You know, I have you guys, and I have, like, everyone that chills with me in my Discord, and I'm very happy for that. And I think I've wasted a ton of time also playing Apex Legends and Overwatch with, like, I think it's been Fortnite that I've blown the most time here with. Because, like, most of the people that when I first started streaming in junk, it was PUBG, Overwatch, and Fortnite. And everyone, like, a lot of people didn't like Overwatch very much, but they'd play freaking Fortnite with me no problem, no questions asked. I've played Fortnite since the very beginning, but way before they were even talking about having seasons.
Fortnite is not good.
You're not
what
good.
What games do you play, Riley? What's the game you've played the most?
Yeah, Mr. Man, what game have you blown the most hours on?
You see, I don't really, for the longest, time, I've never really, like, binged, like, one singular video game. Like, unless you count, like, every Pokemon game as one thing, I haven't really done a lot of binging of a single game since I was, like, young kid. But if you want to talk about when I was a young kid, guys.
So, like, three or four years ago?
This is an answer you were not expecting. When I was in fourth and fifth grade, I must have played, like, hundreds of hours of Animal Jam.
Animal Jam?
Oh, no.
I've never heard of that game. Please explain explain to me what Animal Jam is.
So Animal Jam... National Geographic browser MMO, where you make your own animal friend and you get to go be an animal in a world with a bunch of other animals.
Yeah, it's webkins, like, for poor people.
Dear God.
Yeah, you can play educational mini games. You can talk to friends. You can meet other animals. You can do weird fetish role plays if you're into that. I think I got roped into some of those by accident.
Yeah, quote-unquote accident. Yeah, 10. Huge football goalpost size freaking quotation marks. Accidents.
I didn't know that the teddy bear was coming on to me, all right?
It's like, you know, maybe, well, then again, I don't know, like, you didn't get told to by anyone to, like, come to their house.
I'm pretty sure being a pet is a fetish, and I definitely did do a role play where people were my pets without knowing the...
Oh my God.
Not that I would know, but it definitely is a fetish.
And how long did this go on?
Not super long, but...
Okay, was it...
There's a word for that, I think. It's called... Isn't it called grooming?
Yeah, it's like, you know... Yeah, exactly. I was going to go say... you know, pet, maybe, you know, just, my God. Riley, were you being fucking groomed in this game?
He's also just come out live on a podcast as a bottom.
Oh, my God. And another piece of the puzzle falls into place.
See, I played an ungodly amount of Animal Jam when I was younger.
Okay, Riley, we're going to go ahead and move past this part. This is going to be something for your therapist in a couple of years for you to, both to go over. But how much time in, say, a Pokemon game, preferably one where you didn't dress up as like a Squirtle or a Pikachu and get petted vigorously by the same person many times over an extended period of time? What Pokemon game would you say you've played the most in your life? Dear God.
I mean, I don't really know which one I played the most, but I know my favorite one, and also literally my favorite video game of all time.
And what is your favorite video game of all time?
Pokemon X and Y.
Well, X and Y is that.
Wow.
God damn it, Mo.
Hey, I had to listen to you talk about being groomed in a fucking game I'd never heard about. I mean, my God, like, this world is fucked. This world
now
is.
We get to hear Riley talk about his time on IMVU, like.
Oh dear God! Like, please tell me, like, you didn't like meet a guy named Onision by a chance, did you?
I don't remember.
Oh dear God!
It very well might have been.
Oh God. Oh. Oh man.
So X and Y were the first entry in the series on the 3DS. And the first entry in the series to include full 3D graphics.
So the first game you played?
No. The first game I played was Pokemon Pearl.
Nice. That was the first one I really played, like, consciously as a as my own.
I mean, I was conscious enough to like understand, but I also literally only used my starter until my cousin stole my starter, and then I literally only used a Haunter.
What Pokemon did you start off with?
I started off with a Chimchar.
Hell yeah, the best starter in all of Pokemon.
What is that? Because I are a stupid boomer, and me know enough about Pokemon to hold a conversation.
Monkey who is fire.
Oh my god. Monkey. No shit, so you had like a little badass Mojo Jojo.
Yes.
Nice. See, now I'm already into this. Is way better than your being groomed story. I mean, you should have led with that. Like,
you should have seen the monkey on Animal Jam.
Oh, was he trying to touch you in your no-no square?
No, the best animal in Animal Jam is the penguin, because the thing about Animal Jam is that there's an underwater world and a ground world, and the only animal that can access both is the penguin. So penguin is the chat animal.
So you did not play a penguin.
I did not play penguin.
You sound like you were a bottom monkey.
I think. Oh,
what animal were you?
Actually.
Oh no.
Hold on, repeat that.
I think I was a monkey.
Oh my god. Oh, okay. So let's go back to Pokemon.
Okay. So the story. I want to tell the story about how my cousin stole my starter.
All right, go ahead.
So he wanted me to train something for him, and I'm like, why not? I have literally no other friends, so I'll train this Pokemon for you. Why not? So he trains me his Pokemon. For some reason, I trade him my starter, my Infernape. And he refuses to give it back.
Aw, that's some bitch stuff, man.
For any Moe's out of the loop, Infernape is the third evolution of Chimchar, the Fire Monkey starter.
Chimchar and Infernape. Dude, I really like these names, man. This is fucking awesome.
Yeah, it goes Chimchar, Monferno, Infernape.
See, they're all derivatives of monkey or some sort of a simian or primate, if you will. You know, I love that. I'm already super into that. That makes me want to play that Pokemon game.
Oh, highly recommend. Hiplok,
the shitty one, Empoleon. And then there's a Turtwig.
Piplup, the shitty one, Empoleon.
What's the middle of Turtwig?
Grottle.
Oh, terrible. It's a great name, but also...
No, Grottle's a Chad. Grottle's
it's
an
a good
absolute
name.
Chad.
Because it's a play on, like, Grotto. But, God, it's horrible in the evolutionary line. And then, yeah, Torterra. Torterra's
a
Chad.
Grottle's
a
Chad, you don't even know. Torterra's but anyway, what happened in Pearl was when my starter got stolen, I happened upon... This was in Snow Point City, the city with the 7th gym. There happened to be a person who's like... hey, I have a Haunter. I want a Medicham. Will you trade me? And I happened to have a random Medicham, so I was like, why not? And I traded him. The Haunter did not evolve, because it was holding an Everstone, so it didn't evolve with the trade. So you got a Haunter. And me, having... nothing better to do, and apparently a much better attention span than I do now, went and grinded this Haunter to like level 77 and beat the rest of the game with this Haunter, who later became a Gengar because I had a friend who traded him so he could evolve. So that's the story of my Gengar, who was actually the first and I believe only Pokemon I've ever leveled to level 100.
Yeah, if you level a Pokemon to level 100, it's pretty easy to just beat the whole game.
Well, I didn't level it up to level 100 until after I beat the game. How I leveled it up to 100
even with,
was I just fought the Elite Four.
Even
if it's
not very effective, it's like, if you have one level 100, even if you're not very effective, it's just... It's like the Elite Fours have like one
level 60s,
65s, like...
Right before the third gym in Pokemon Soul Silver, my friend's older brother traded me a level 100 Typhlosion, and I beat the whole game with it.
That's a good starter, too. Did you take that, you saw that test, spreading around? The, like, what's your starter path?
I did not see that.
It was like, which starter did you pick in each generation?
For me, my starters... Well, my preferred starters of each generation, I don't remember if I picked all of them first go around, but I picked...
Yeah,
my favorite starters of each generation are Bulbasaur for Gen 1.
Yep, I agree.
Cyndaquil for Gen 2.
I agree.
Gen 2 is actually, like, one of the best starter trios. Like, I love all three of those.
It's the closest. I mean, I think Totodile's the weakest, but...
Totodile is the weakest of the three, but they're all really good.
Yeah.
There's usually, like, an obvious weak one, and Gen 2 didn't really have that. Gen 3 was Treecko for me.
Ooh, now we disagree, because obviously Torchic is overpowered.
But can we agree that Mudkip is the worst one?
Yeah, well... If we don't consider their
Robin.
If we don't consider their evolutions, sure. But like,
I'm not talking Swampert, statistically. I'm
Swampert
just talking
is like
design
awesome.
Preference.
I mean, I'm talking about a little of both.
Okay.
Swampert's really cool.
Sceptile's cool. Then there's Gen 4, obviously Chimchar.
We agree.
Chimchar,
on that.
Best monkey, best boy. Gen 5. Has always been a really hard pick for me. Like, it's very hard for me to choose between Tepig and Snivy, but more recently I've been preferring Snivy.
Yep, I agree there.
What's Snivy?
He's a little grass snake.
Oh, cool. What's he evolve into? What's the big payoff for him?
Superior.
Ooh, cool.
Big snake.
What's he do? Like, what's his attack?
Well, he's grass.
Grass.
Yeah.
I don't know what that means.
They're all grass, fire, and water. They don't always have, like, a super special move. He probably does, but I don't remember it that well.
I don't think Superior... Well, he's most well-known for a Leaf Storm. He uses Leaf Storm a lot.
Yeah, but, like, every grass Pokemon has Leaf Storm.
Yeah, but, like, he's the most synonymous with that move because of his use in competitive. Yeah.
Oh,
because
he has that one, that
his
one ability.
Contrary, as I said,
yeah,
ability,
contrary.
Which makes it so,
yeah.
Like, contrary, Mo, this is me, Riley, explaining this to Mo.
Oh, okay, good.
Stealing his concept.
Yeah, Riley explained this to me.
Sometimes in Pokemon, they'll have moves that have, like, super powerful power, like, super powerful, like, base power.
Yeah.
But they also lower a stat. So, like, there's this thing called Leaf Storm, which is, like, super powerful, but it lowers your special attack, which means next time you use it, it won't be as powerful. But there's some Pokemon that have an ability called Contrary, which basically reverses that. So instead of it having it lower the stat, it makes the stat go higher. And that's what Superior has, so he just uses Leaf Storm all the time.
So it's basically like one of the more cheesy freaking Pokemon classes out there, then.
Yeah, the Contrary ability is very cheesy, yes.
Oh, man.
And then, yeah, Xerneas Power with, what's that move? Oh, God, it's disgusting. I don't even want to think about it.
Geomancy?
Oh, God.
But yeah. Anyway,
what's Geomancy?
The last three starters here. Gen 6,
yeah.
Froakie.
Yeah, not a question.
Gen 7, Litten.
Ooh, but Rowlet.
Rowlet's pretty good.
I
prefer Litten at the end of the day, but I really do like Rowlet, too.
Yeah, I mean, Litten's second favorite.
No, when they first got revealed, when we only saw first forms, I was hardcore Team Popplio.
Popplio's just horrible.
But then Evolutions got revealed, and I was like, this middle form is disgusting.
Popplio's like the most forgotten starter, I think.
Popplio's middle form is like one of the most horrible Pokemon.
What about Tepig?
My least favorite Pokemon, actually, I forgot to mention this when we talked about Gen 6 starters. A Gen 6 starter does hold the place as literally my least favorite Pokemon, and that is the Chespin line, particularly Quilladin. I hate them.
Would you say that you would, like, take time out of your day to shoo it away from all the Pokemon so it doesn't, like, get its fail and nonsense all over the party that you love, your favorites?
I would kick a Quilladin as if it was a soccer ball. Across.
Would you
the curb world.
Stomp a Quilladin for $1 million?
I'd curb stomp a Quilladin for $5.
Damn.
I hate Tepig.
I'd curb stomp a Quilladin for a Klondike bar.
Tepig is the most disgusting evolutionary line. It's just horrible.
I love Pignite and Emboar.
It's horrible. It's disgusting.
But anyway, just the last starter here. so we can get off this, because I'm sure Mo is like itching to say something else.
No, that's completely fine. That's completely fine. Like, you know, I know there's a lot of people that listen to this show that who play a lot of Pokemon or have played Pokemon. So, you know, they have something to listen to. They're probably like screaming at the freaking at their fucking computer monitor right now, going, no, Pidgey, or whatever the equivalent is to that. But, you know, like I said, my Pokemon knowledge is very limited. Like, I don't remember half the Pokemon. Like, I don't remember.
Gen, Sword and Shield.
Grookey Gang.
Scorbunny Gang.
Grookey Gang. Oh, no. They didn't give Scorbunny fighting. Oh, horrible.
Honestly, when the first... It's another thing. Sobble has Popplio Syndrome, because when the first forms got revealed, I was Team Sobble. But then the evolutions got revealed. Well, the evolutions got leaks. They weren't supposed to be revealed, but they were. And I was like, I really like this line for Scorbunny, and I picked Scorbunny.
What the hell is a Scorbunny?
He's a bunny who is fire and also is soccer themed.
I can't imagine those two things ever being good in a combination, because
it's
now
mono fire,
no,
but
he has
all
a special move.
Fighting type.
But here's
he
the
has
thing.
A special move. No,
but here,
his
but
final
here's
evolution.
The, but here's the thing
final
that
evolution.
I. God damn it! Here's the thing
I'm
that's.
I'm trying to tell you.
I know, I'm trying to like make this like crazy point real quick. The only thing that I can think of whenever you say fire and bunny and soccer ball is a bunny that was set on fire that was then beamed in the freaking face by a freaking soccer ball. And, you know, that's like fucking horrific. Like a horrific image in my mind.
White, red, and orange. And his final evolution has a special move called a pyro ball, where he kicks a soccer ball at you, but the soccer ball is a fireball.
That's also its only fire-type move, because they're all fighting.
It gets blaze kick and flame charge.
Yeah, like I said, it wishes it was firefighting, but it's not.
It has a lot of weird coverage. Like, Cinderace has a lot of like good and weird coverage options. Like, it gets poison coverage, it gets steel coverage.
Like, I think Inteleon is the best out of them, like, objectively the best, but Grookey's
just
so cute.
I mean, the best competitively is Cinderace, no question, because...
No, but sniping things is cool.
Yeah, cool factor. Inteleon is pretty cool. But he just looks
And Grookey's
weird.
Adorable.
Like, I was hoping Sobble would sort of keep, like, his sad, cutie aesthetic, but he did not.
Plus, doesn't Grookey remind you of your Animal Jam days?
Grookey does.
Grookey is
a close second for me.
Oh, Grookey's did he?
Grookey's a grass monkey.
Did he try to pet you too? Over an extended period of time.
Yeah, Grookey tried to pet me.
Oh no! Dirty Grookey. Hashtag time's up for Grookey.
No, wait. Do you think that I was the pet? No. I was the owner, Mo. Don't get it wrong.
I don't know, man. There's just some crazy...
Dom? Yeah, you really give off Dom vibes, Riley. Oh, my God. You sound so alpha all the time.
Welcome to the MoCast. We talk about grooming and joke about it immensely.
Today's episode is about our favorite games, which we haven't gotten to yet.
Well, y'all have been talking about Pokemon. I had to go run off and put up the fucking chickens real quick, and then you know you guys were having a pretty decent conversation about Pokemon, so I didn't really want to interrupt it. But let's go ahead and wrap
Can
up.
Can Mo stream Pokemon? Because I'd watch that like religiously.
He's got to do KOTOR first.
Yeah, I've got a freaking Final Fantasy 3. I need to be. I'm at the Tower of the Magi right now in the World of Ruin. And then after that, it's going to be a week of speedrun practice and trying to do some speedruns. And because, like, I really fucking miss doing speedrunning. Like, I'm super, super into that. I didn't think I was actually going to be into it. I thought it was just going to be a passing phase. What was this one game I was playing that everyone was super, super into? And I played it for like 15, 20 minutes. And then I fucking just cast it off to the wayside. I think it was let's see here. You know, I think it was like a freaking Destiny 2. In fact, I'm pretty sure it was Destiny 2 because I loved the shit out of the very first Destiny. I thought it was a really great fucking game. But then all the stupid shit surrounding it started, like, getting kind of crazy.
No, it's super easy to get into Destiny 2. All you have to do is you have to commit a bunch of hours and then pay, like, $300 for all of the expansions. Plus, you have to buy the game itself.
Yeah, so much for the 10-year plan, right? You know, when the very first Destiny got put out, there was this
Mo,
huge...
can we do one goddamn episode without you bringing up the plan? Jesus.
Well, I didn't bring up the plan. The Destiny people had a plan. The Bungie people had
the
plan.
Oh, the Destiny plan. I gotcha.
Yeah, what plan are you
talking about your terrorism plan.
No.
The plan, you know?
Oh, that plan. Wink, wink, nudge, nudge. Say no more. Oh, that's... That meeting is at the docks at 10 o'clock tonight. Just y'all two be there, okay? Because Riley...
We're meeting up in the Cameron Clark server, right? You know,
Yeah. Riley, don't be fucking late this time, because you've been late twice, and I've... Like, these are the type of... The people I'm talking to, they just do not like... They like punctuality, okay? So you better fucking be there, because I might not be here.
If I don't start showing up on time, they're going
Punctuality is a really traditional value, you know?
Oh, yeah, especially in this, you know, the little industry I'm dipping my toe in. You know, I can't really, there's no sick days here, Riley. Anyway, before we...
If I don't start showing up on time, they're going to cast me back into Animal Jam. It's a weird terrible place again.
What is
your favorite video game?
I think one of my favorite video games... let's go ahead and start off with the SNES, because I think that's the console that really defined my love for gaming. Even though I loved gaming since, like, the Atari 2600, which I was a youngin' back when that was released brand new. Goddamn. Sorry about that. I think it would have to be Legend of Zelda: A Link to the Past. I cannot get tired of playing that game. I must have played it several times in the last, like, 3 years alone. And each time, I still kind of forget. I think this is the best thing about that game, is that no matter how many times you play it, you can still forget just some minor stupid little detail, going left when you're supposed to go right, bombing the wrong wall, etc., etc. And it throws you off your game, so to speak. And I love playing that game because I relearn the game every single time. And even though it's never going to be like the very first time I've ever played it, I think I still appreciate it immensely, and even more every single time I play it for a repeated, you know, blah, blah, blah. I don't know where the fuck I was going with that last little bit.
Is this your next speedrun game?
Zelda is bad and makes me angry.
Shut up, Riley. Shut your fucking trap. Anyway.
Wow, that's a horrible
thing. No, literally, way back in the day, this is classic Riley.
What, like 2 years ago?
Back when I was, yes.
This yeah, is, way, way wait, back.
This is back in my
half
YouTube
a lifetime
days
ago.
Is what I meant. When I was, when I used to be known as Pegasus the Gamer, and I made Let's Plays on the YouTube space, I played Legend of Zelda: Link's Awakening. And that Let's Play is famous for just having me be angry and having no idea where to go the whole time and making almost no progress.
Kids these days have no imagination.
And for crying out loud, how did you not, like, after the first, like, 20 minutes of being lost, just go, okay, fuck it, I'm just going to YouTube the solution? Because I've done that 3 or 4 times on live stream going, okay, I don't know where the hell...
Here's why. I was talking to a Twitch streamer who I used to watch religiously and would still if he was still streaming.
You get it, Monkey, haha.
Not Monkey. It was a Pokemon streamer named Master Engine. And we talked about Legend of Zelda and how I didn't like it because I couldn't beat it without a walkthrough, and I thought that walkthroughs defeated the point. And
no, just sometimes you gotta have a walkthrough, because back in those days, man, we didn't really have an effective internet. We started having a decent internet back then, like in the mid-90s, but back those days...
You call the
like,
game helpline, and then for $1 a minute, they'll help you out with what you're stuck on.
Oh, man, those are the biggest
Would they
freaking
explain
suck...
explain it in, like, the longest way
on.
Possible so they get the most money from you?
Yes.
Yeah, because that's the scam. Yeah, those guys are freaking suckers, man. Like, my mom and dad, like my mom specifically, whenever those freaking commercials would come on, before I go, hey, Ma, no, you're not calling that fucking number. No, you just keep playing the game until you can't go no more. Now Chase's turn, give him the controller. And, you know, like, I was forbidden, you know, because, like, we were... super, super, like, working class. We couldn't afford some 1-900 freaking number to go talk about video games in the most slowly paced freaking phone call designed ever by humanity. It's just not going to happen.
Okay, so what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to turn on the console, and you're going to want to wait for the game to load. Let me know when the game's done loading. I'll wait.
By the way, what'd you have for dinner tonight? I had spaghetti. You know, I made some really good spaghetti. You know, I put a little bit of herbs and garlic and spice on the chicken. I chopped it up. And, you know, that
Tell
made me
me
start...
Tell me every individual herb you use.
Yes, you know, I thought to myself, what a wonderful day it was. Oh, yeah, video games. We'll get to that in just a minute. And then your call would just go on and on and on. Like, just watching the episode of The Simpsons where Homer gets freaking screwed. Gets screwed out of a bunch of money because he called a 1-900 freaking sports hotline, tip hotline. It's fucking great. But anyway, Oh, I'm sorry that this is my part, you know, because I was going to talk about Legend of Zelda. Oh, do you want to talk some more, Mr. Riley?
Yeah, I wanted to say something.
Oh, well, my bad. I didn't know this was your segment. Go ahead.
I'm sorry. I just wanted to say
that. I guess it'll just be the Riley cast and not the Mo cast. Maybe I should just go to the bathroom and just sulk for like 15 minutes. No big deal. Anyway, you were talking about your Zelda experience when you were a young man.
Why are you being so mean to me?
Because you said Zelda was a bad game. And you destroyed my freaking childlike innocence. What little childlike innocence I have inside of me.
So Mass told me that if I... He questioned my maturity if I couldn't figure out Legend of Zelda without a walkthrough.
I have to second that.
I was like, all right. Fuck it. And I started a Let's Play of Link's Awakening. I'm like, no walkthroughs. Not allowed. And it was just a lot of me getting lost, getting upset, and my editor making fun of me within the editing.
Oh, see, that's the best part, man. Like, I work for these people that say they insist that I make fun of them with the editing a little bit. And lately, since they've been breaking out their paranormal stuff, I've just been letting them fucking really, really have it. And on top of that, they're Canadian and I'm American. So you got that American snark coming in there a little bit because I've already referenced Canadian workplace fatalities and injuries and shit. I think I've offended a few of their paranormal fans because they got a couple of downvotes a couple of a paranormal video or two ago. But yeah, you should have led off with the whole no walkthroughs allowed, because that would have spared you my previous rant that I gave you. So next time you should lead with that.
Actually, so Link's Awakening, they actually remade that one pretty recently.
Oh, re-re.
And obviously, my Game Boy Color, the one that I played on the Great Quick Color, I haven't done that Let's Play in 2 years. That Let's Play is not available anymore because I privated my YouTube channel.
Oh,
coward.
I went to my friend's house and we, like, 2 months ago, and we recorded, I recorded 4 episodes of a Let's Play of the Switch remake with him. And he is yet to send me the files. So eventually I'm going to bully him into sending me the files. And then on my BitChute, there'll be like 3-month-old 3-month-old Link's Awakening videos going up.
See, that's the beautiful part of it, man. As long as you don't reference the time and date this was recorded, you know, you could put it on any time.
I'm pretty sure I definitely said something that alludes to the date.
See, there you go. You dated your own product. See, you should be doing that. Because
he was supposed to send them to me like a couple days later. And it's been months and he still hasn't sent them. Because he's not editing them, he's just sending me the files, but he kept forgetting, and now his graphics card all fucked up, so he can't use his computer because the screen's all fucked.
Well, that's a game you hate, Riley. What's a game that you like? What's your favorite game?
Yeah, yeah. What's one of your favorite games, Riley? Go ahead.
Yeah, well, I already said my all-time favorite game was Pokemon X and Y. But another one I really like is Grand Theft Auto V. It's a good game.
Oh, nice, nice, nice. I really like that game a whole lot. I don't think it's as good as 3 or 4, but I think it's still groundbreaking nonetheless, and I've had nothing but a great time playing it. Not such a great time online, because I think it's just a freaking a shit heap and a half, the GTA Online experience. I mean, I'll put it to you this way. The GTA San Andreas Online experience, the multiplayer experience, way, way better than the GTA 5 experience. And they weren't even trying with the online experience with San Andreas. So, ugh. But yeah, go ahead, buddy.
Yeah, so GTA 5 is a really good game. The plot, I really like the story. I really like the gameplay, obviously, because I've always been into Grand Theft Auto. So, yeah, I really like it. Like, I've even called it my favorite game of all time before, until I actually, like, had to sit down and make my top 10 favorite games for a podcast, and then it ended up at, like, number 4 or something.
Oh, no shit. Yeah, dude, that's why I hate top 10 lists, because you always have this idea of what you think are your, like, top favorite games. But once you really commit more than a couple of minutes to that subject, you find out what you really, really like.
I could probably do it.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, Robin, what's one of your favorite games?
How about I give you my favorite game?
Oh, your absolute favorite game?
My favorite game.
All right.
It's Dark Souls 1.
Dark Souls, dude. A lot of people fucking love the shit out of that game. And I bought it like about a month ago. I prepared to play it, and I'm going to be doing a Let's Play on that. Oh, dude, I'm going to be doing Let's Plays of that for my first vanilla playthrough, since my internet is shit and I can't live stream it like I would originally like to. But, yeah. Go ahead and tell us your Dark Souls 1 experience.
Well, I had never played Demon's Souls. I've played it now, obviously. But, like, it wasn't like I had known what Dark Souls was before playing it. But my friend, who I still talk to, actually, to this day, told me there's a sequel to this game, Demon's Souls, that he played on the PS3 coming out soon. Or on the PS2, rather. No, it's on the PS3. It was early PS3, that's what it was. Coming out soon. That is called Dark Souls, and it's like the spiritual successor to the game, and that I should pick it up. And so that was one of two games I got that year, which both of them are probably my top two favorite games of all time, which is Dark Souls and Dishonored.
I think I might have Dishonored. That looks like a really great game. That and Bloodborne, which I've had a copy in my hand several times, and I'm like, nah, I don't have the money for it right now, or maybe I'll go buy it later.
Bloodborne is by the people who made Dark Souls.
Yeah, the original Dark Souls, and like people have been telling me about that game for like years now. And I'm super, super hyped to play that game.
It's just beautiful. The storytelling is great. The combat has really, like, even to this day, has shaped all of combat in all single-player games. Jedi Fallen Order, you can tell, is Dark Souls-inspired. All of the combats in any game are now Dark Souls-inspired. Like, it has completely shaped the, like, third-person... like sword fighting style type of game, like the combat for it.
Mm-hmm.
And then like the story in Dark Souls is just, it's vague, like intentionally vague, where like you don't really get many details on it. A lot of the details you get are from like reading the descriptions of items and like interpreting the story yourself.
Yeah. That I've seen that movie is very that movie. I've seen that that game from all the streams that I've watched is very lore heavy and very text heavy in a lot.
It's very lore
like,
heavy, but not lore heavy. If you don't want to look at the lore, if you don't want to read items, if you don't want to like pay attention, you just play the game, and the game still functions properly. But if you really want to dig into it, you know, you can read, like, you find a key and you'll read about what, like, the history of the key or, like, what you think the history of the key is, your, like, your character, the chosen undead.
Yeah.
You'll get, like, a set of clothing and you can read that and it'll tell you about, like, the history of this clothing.
God, that
that's how you get the history of the game.
God, that reminds me of all of the books in Skyrim, because I had to stop playing Skyrim for the longest time because I would sit there and I'd forget that I was playing the game.
Yeah,
because
I love me a Lusty Argonian Maid, I'll tell you what.
Oh, dude, I've read the Lusty Argonian Maid. I've read the Wolf Queen, or it's the chick that turns into a wolf. She's one of the most powerful, like, war... What the... Hey, Riley, buddy?
You okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. What?
Yeah, because, like, dude, it sounds like you're just, like, chunking forks at a fan or something, bro.
Yeah, you're scraping a bowl with a fork. Like,
I am not chunking forks at a fan, bro. Don't worry.
Well, every time I'm trying to get, it's like, you know, I'm sorry. Just, like, you use your finger and wipe the circumference of the bowl like a normal person. All right, don't use the fork. Hey, anyway, I'm sorry. Anyway,
Luke.
Yes, use the forks.
Use the
forks. Yes, use the forks, Riley. Use the forks. Anyway.
It's a spoon, actually.
A fucking spoon. I know that was more God, that aggravates me even fucking more. Anyway.
Spoon, Lottie fucking
oh, yeah, but anyway, I guess let me make sure that I read this right. So the very first boss of Dark Souls, didn't the developers have to nerf the boss in an update because everyone was complaining that it was just too damn hard and no one could get past the first boss?
The Asylum Demon? Like the first boss? Like the tutorial boss?
It was just the rumor that I've heard for like the last couple of years. It's really popular on the Reddit pages and on 4chan.
There's like three answers to what the first boss is. I mean, there's like literally the first boss is the Asylum Demon.
It's the first boss in the game that you actually face at the end of the very first level.
Yeah, that would be the Asylum Demon. It's fucking easy, dude. They give you all the keys to the kingdom.
Okay, so
to me, the whole game is easy, but that's because I've played it a whole lot.
Oh, okay, that was just that was a rumor that I have heard that they had to nerf the shit out of it.
They may have.
Oh man, that's gotta be a hell of a that sounds like a hell of a game if that's really what the devs had to do for an update. Like no one could like your boss is so badass that you can't freaking get past it.
Design philosophy of From Software that they wouldn't have just nerfed a boss because it was too hard.
I like From Software.
Yeah, that's their whole like thing. Is they're like it's hard. If you want to play
the
game,
thing I know about
the beat the boss
is that it's like so infamously hard that like every time a hard game comes out, there's always like some game journalist who's like, "This is the Dark Souls.
This is
of
the Dark Souls
genre
game,
or
yeah.
franchise."
Oh my god, I hate that shit too, because like they're like, this is the Dark Souls of video games. Like, bitch, this is even the ghouls and ghosts of games.
Dark Souls of video games is Dark Souls.
It's a good thing you roasted him for that, because I said the exact same thing like 3 seconds before him.
I can't stand that shit though, because like I remember when
this is the Dark Souls of tycoons.
Like I remember. Go ahead.
They called Crash Bandicoot and Sane Trilogy the Dark Souls of platformers.
Oh yes, no, and that's such horse shit because the fucking people who were reviewing that game suck at video games. No one in the industry, in that industry specifically, no one ever, like maybe 2-3 people max, fucking actually play video games. Anyone who thinks, even with the dated controls of the Crash Bandicoot series. If you're having trouble getting past the first couple of sub-levels in level 1, you probably should just go back to playing Candy Crush or something. Because you know what? You don't have the hand-eye coordination, or you don't have the patience. The game doesn't even really make you think. And
I would argue the...
I mean, to be fair, I'm pretty bad at Crash Bandicoot.
Riley, hold on a sec. Robin, what you were saying?
Oh, I was going to say, I would argue that the Dark Souls of platformers is like BitTrip Runner or something.
I've never played that game. Which system is that on?
I remember playing demo.
It's an indie game. I think it was
on
the
Wii.
I was going to say, I think it's on the Wii. It was on the 360. It's almost definitely on Steam. It's like a rhythm game platformer type thing.
Oh man, your rhythm game.
I can't
play
it because when things move too fast on the screen, my eyes can't process it. There's like something wrong in my brain when things are moving too quickly on a screen.
Holy shit, guys. BitTrip Runner. Oh my god. I heard somebody watching a video of a video game, and I heard like the music, and I'm like, what the fuck is this? It's so familiar to me. And now I know why, because it was fucking BitTrip Runner, and I played that demo so much as a kid.
Man, I'll tell you what demo and what my other favorite game is. This is one of my second favorite ones. This is a demo that I got back in the day when there was this magazine called, I think it was the Official PlayStation Monthly Magazine. You'd get it once a month. Yeah, well, this is back in the late 90s, early 2000s, right? So, like, they had no concept of, like,
PMM.
Yeah, we hadn't invented marketing by then.
Yeah, they had no concept of, like, spatial texting, you know, it's just spacing text out in a better way.
Nintendo got that right with Nintendo Power, like, 20 years before.
Well, yeah, but that's Nintendo Power, though. You can't really compare Nintendo Power to, like, PlayStation Magazine or, you know, any of the other ones. Because Nintendo Power, for the longest time, was king. But I tell you one thing. It got knocked off its seat of inscrutable power by a PlayStation Magazine or a PSM, if you were like in hip to it back in the early the mid 90s, because
wait,
that
are we talking about PMSing?
No, we're not talking about PMSing. We're talking about PlayStation Magazine or PlayStation Monthly to some people. You could say, I guess you could
say PMS then?
Did I say that?
I don't know. Did you?
You said PSM, Robin.
Oh, I thought we were talking about, you know.
Well, you can say I did get my I was getting my monthlies because, you know, I monthly get my three or four magazines.
Right,
but,
right, of course.
But anyway, so this one Official PlayStation Magazine came with a demo disc, right? And on that disc was actually Crash Bandicoot and a couple of other.
Yo, was it PlayStation Underground?
There we go. Yeah, PlayStation
Holy
Underground.
Shit.
PlayStation Underground has encompassed some of the best practices of the old school video game industry. Nothing like it is now, where it's basically just all schlock and bullshit. It gave you viable demos of the upcoming games that were coming out. And not every single one of those games ever saw the light of day. Some of them we only got the demos for. Like there was this horror game that was also a fighting game that was nixed because people complained too much that it was just too violent and bloody. And what was crazy is that Mortal Kombat 2 was more violent and bloody than that. And it was really neat because it was a 3D style. It was when the 3D style of a Virtua Fighter type fighting games were coming out.
This might be a little bit of a tangent, but I heard a story about Mortal Kombat that I thought was really cool, where they put in like the fatalities in Mortal Kombat 1.
Yeah.
As like a little like secret thing, but they were like, nobody's ever gonna find this thing, because like you have to hit like a crazy amount of buttons in a certain order, and like the odds of that happening are like insane, right? For
yeah, it's like a million to one.
Yeah, it's something ridiculous. Like nobody's gonna find it for such a long time. So, you know, Ed Boon or whoever made the first Mortal Kombat, I assume it was Ed Boon, you know, goes to the arcade and, like, puts in his first arcade machine or whatever, and this kid goes up to it, and he plays, like, Sub-Zero or Scorpion or something, and gets a fatality and rips the other person's, like, rips the AI's head off, and he goes around the whole arcade, and he's like, dude, I just ripped this guy's head off, and everyone's like, what are you talking about? Like, he just kicked him on the ground, and they fall down and die. He's like, no, I ripped his head off. This is, like, the first time anyone's, like, played the game, really. Like, this is in, like, the first week.
Holy shit.
Goes around the arcade, like, I did it. And he's like, he plays all of his quarters trying to do it again. And he goes around begging other people for quarters, and he can't replicate it.
Oh, no.
Oh, man. People used to get pissed off at that fucking game back in the day. Which, you know, it was kind of crazy because, like, you know, everyone's going to bitch about violent video games, but everyone's not going to bitch about how fucking Rambo and all the action movies come out of Hollywood wasn't, like, ultra-violent.
That way.
Oh, well, yeah, shit, man. I mean, Platoon, I think when I was younger, was probably the bloody... Well, Platoon and the very first RoboCop, I thought was way, way bloodier than Mortal Kombat ever was. Because, like, when you're a kid, you can see that this is a facade, right? Like, the giant blood puddles spewing forth from the fucking player when you hit him with your upper punch. You know, it's just like, it's just spraying all over the place. Like, only a fool would ever take this game so seriously. So to see, like, Congress and Tipper Gore and the PMRC and all the and the FCC, all those types, Captain fucking Kangaroo, to see all those types freak out over that game, but still, like, watch shit like the Platoon movies and Rambo and Rocky and all that. And I love all those movies too, but they were still much, much more violent than anything else from Mortal Kombat was.
Because you're causing the violence, Mo. That's the point. You're the one instigating the violence in this case.
Well, that's a fucking stupid premise.
If I read the tone wrong in a text conversation and I accidentally say something mean in an RPG, I have to, like, reset the whole game. Like, what do you...
Yeah, that really fucking sucks. I mean, you can even say that about RPGs, how the main character is a freaking kleptomaniac, because you go into everyone's house.
That's fine. That's not a big deal. Stealing is fine. But if you accidentally say something mean to someone, you have to reset the whole game. It's like, oh, fuck, I said the wrong thing. I've made someone upset. I've made a character upset with me. I have to restart.
Shit. You know, I almost forgot what the point I was making. You know, I got off on sort of a tangent there after you went on your little tangent. But anyway, the coolest thing about the PlayStation Underground thing was that demo disc. And on that demo disc was this game called Intelligence Cube. And it was it's a non-violent, since we're talking about violent video games, I figured I preface this with saying this. It was
it's a video game, so it must be violent.
Dun dun dun. And you worked with bombs, so I must be a terrorist.
Oh, fuck.
Oh, yeah. Well, no, nah, anyway.
It matched really well with Riley calling you a terrorist in the first 5 seconds of this episode.
Oh, God. Riley, God, I swear. I know I'm going to have to edit that part out. Fuck. Anyway, yada, yada, yada. Now, you go around as this faceless, almost shapeless guy. He's running around setting down little bombs on the ground, and your objective is to destroy the jet black blocks that are connected to the blocks around it, because every time you blow away one of these blocks, it blows away one of those, and you can get past those.
Holy
you won't get
shit, I remember what you're talking about.
And you won't get squashed by those bricks, and you won't get dropped off the map, because every time you fail to get rid of a block, it nixes just a small segment of the level that you're standing on. So there's a ticking time bomb, or there's a ticking clock, and there's the puzzle aspect of it, because you can only set down one little bomb at a time. And I must have played that demo for hours and hours and hours, because I loved the shit out of it. And if you play it fast enough, because it was a timed demo, you could play like two or three of the actual levels in the game, but that's only after you got really good at it. But that's one of my favorite games.
What's that game called?
It's called Intelligence Cubed. or an intelligent cube?
Holy shit. I'm going to go get that game, like, right now.
Oh, dude. I wanted to, since I still have my old PlayStation here, I'm thinking about grabbing a physical copy of it and just so I can play it like that, because I missed the shit out of those days.
A couple of months ago, my brother gave me the best gift in the world. He found our original PlayStation from when we were children, and that completes my set. I have all the PlayStations now.
Oh man! Oh, that's fucking awesome. You know, I think the thumbnail for this one will be, I'm gonna take a picture of my old PlayStation that I got, and the reason why I want to do that is it still has the old memory card, and it still has the sticker from one of the official PlayStation, I think the official PlayStation magazines issues.
Oh, that's dope.
Yeah, they used to, every once in a while, magazines used to come with some extra stuff besides like a demo disc like PlayStation Underground. They used to come with like little fold-out posters and stuff like that. And every
You're
once in a while,
Playboys.
Well, Playboys, that too, but also PlayStation and video game magazines as well. And this one had a sticker for your lid.
Naked women? Oh.
No, not no, Naked Women. That's not that magazine issue. But it had this sticker for your PlayStation lid, right? Riley, what's wrong, buddy? I'm getting a lot of feedback from you.
You're getting what?
I'm getting a lot of feedback from you.
I don't know.
The wrong kind of feedback. Like microphone feedback, not like replying to a normal conversation like a human being.
I don't know what feedback means.
Robin just explained it to you.
What does it mean? What is my microphone doing?
Well, it's when someone feeds you and then you feed them back.
Oh.
Yeah. It means that. Anyway, so the sticker. Oh, where did you fucking go? God.
What a nightmare of an episode.
Oh, I know. I'm just like, fuck it. But anyway, so the magazine would come with the sticker that it was for your lid, and this one was its Final Fantasy IX edition, so the fucking sticker was the cast and crew from Final Fantasy IX, and a couple of months ago, my dad dug out the PlayStation. Oh, it was the one that was a super...
What's the main character's name?
Zidane.
I gotcha.
Or Zildane. Or however you say, and Vivi, the little the black mage, and that's also, and I'm going to go ahead and end with this. That was also, I think, my favorite PlayStation RPG was Final Fantasy IX, because it was amongst the biggest world that I've ever explored in a Final Fantasy game, and I've been playing Final Fantasy since Final Fantasy I on the Nintendo on the NES, and so.
Final Fantasy 1 or Final Fantasy 1?
Oh, the very first Final Fantasy, the one that the Square based all of its bet all of its hopes and future on, that, because you know the story about where Final Fantasy got its name, correct?
Vaguely, I think.
Okay, the super, super quick version of this story is the company was really having some dire financial times, and they were betting a lot of their... They were betting a lot of their financial future on other products besides video games, and so I think the son of the president of the company was telling his father, "Listen, Dad, let us make this video game. It's all the rage in America and in Japan, and I'm telling you, I think we're going to have a big hit for this, because other than Dragon Warrior." No one really played RPGs at all, so it was a new and exciting and emerging genre. So the dad said, okay, screw it, man. Let's just go ahead and do it. I mean, what do we got to lose except the company? And if we don't turn a profit here soon, we're going to lose the company anyway. So that was their final foray into... that was their very first foray into video gaming and their final foray into making other products non-game related. And they called it Final Fantasy because it was their big final attempt. Because if they fucked this up and it didn't really do well, it was the end of the company.
I thought the big one was Ultima.
Ultima?
Yeah, wasn't that the big, like, RPG? Like, the really big... Wasn't that, like, inspiration for Final Fantasy?
I think it was well, I was playing Dragon Warrior a lot at the time, and I didn't really play Ultima very much as a kid. I knew of it, and I played it a little bit, but I liked Dragon Warrior a lot more up until I got Final Fantasy. But yeah, that's my last game, and we're at the hour and 11 minute mark. So, Robin, do you want to give us your last and final favorite game?
Yeah, okay. I mentioned it, but like Dishonored is so fucking good.
All right.
It's like, oh my god. So like, the morality system in Undertale, like, don't get me wrong, Undertale's great, but like, Dishonored has this like chaos and like lawful kind of system going on, where if you kill people, you're creating chaos, and if you like incapacitate people and you stay stealthy and things, you get like this like the good ending basically. There's like a good ending, bad ending,
yeah,
chaotic ending, lawful ending, and oh my god, the whole game's great. Like the paranormal powers, just they feel, you know, like Blink is your main one, like a teleporting spell. It's just, the game is so fluid, it's so great. I'm so glad I picked that up on release. Like, it's just one of the best games I've ever played.
How would you rate the gameplay?
It's so fun. Especially, like, as much as High Chaos, if that's what it is, High Chaos and Low Chaos. As much as High Chaos is, like, the bad ending, it's so fun to just go around and fucking murder people with, like, your sword and your powers and shit.
You know, one of my favorite, bad guy ending that's supposed to be the bad ending but is the fucking coolest, it was in Jedi Knight Jedi Academy. You have, of course, the light ending and the dark ending. If you pick the dark ending, you kill Kyle Katarin and whoever your friend and mentor was, and you kill, of course, in the tradition of the Sith, you kill your master. And the last scene and the last scene of the game, that was Vader's mistake. The last scene of the game is you standing on the Super Star Destroyer, and you're just looking ominously out the window at the galaxy, and you're about to hunt down rebel scum and probably blow up the freaking Jedi Temple that you're trained under under Luke Skywalker. But anyway, my bad about that. Go ahead with the rest.
You're gonna love KOTOR. By the way,
I know I'm gonna love KOTOR. It's gonna be such a great.
Don't
I'm like,
look anything up.
All right, I promise I will not. There will be nothing to look up. Nothing looked up.
Oh God, it's such a good game. But yeah, Dishonored is great. Fucking everyone should play Dishonored. It's not that long. The story's beautiful. The world building, man, like that's what I love about games is world building. I think most. In single-player games, anyway.
Yeah, that's why I'm really looking forward to Cyberpunk 2020 or 2077.
Yeah,
I think that's what it's called. Yeah, because the EA gameplay, like the hour that they had, I thought was extremely impressive. I really hope that doesn't crap the bed like the other games have done, like, you know, Fallout 76, Anthem. God, I don't want to be depressed, so I'm just going to shut up about those games. But I really hope that isn't shit the bed. I've been playing a lot of Metro 2033 lately. I played a lot of it on stream, but I really like that game series too, and I'm looking forward to the new one that's coming out.
Yeah, I never really got into Metro, but I know it's good. I probably should at some point.
Yeah, it's really neat. For once, we're like this is something I really loved. Is like I love. Not having to be in America for every single game that I'm in. Like, I love the Fallout.
I'm sure not Americans love that, too.
Well, yeah, for the obvious reasons, but, you know,
our
like...
Our culture gets shoved down the throats of every other country.
Oh, my God. Dude, I'm an American, and I'm sick of seeing America in every fucking thing. All I want to do is just, like, you know, I would love to see how, like, the zombie virus is affecting people in France, you know? Then again, Resident Evil did a really good job of branching out in countries and stuff like that. Because there's a few, I think there's a couple levels where you're in Japan, one where you're in New York and all that stuff. But you're all over the world. And a lot of game designers should sort of start
to reflect. New York. It's my favorite non-American place.
Well, shut up. But yeah. That's why I loved Metro 33 so much, because you're in Russia. for this one, and you get to it's really weird how like there's hardly any Russian accents in a Russia game, and how there's hardly anyone in a Russian game speaking Russian, and they're all speaking perfect English, like with like a Eastern accents, but without the pock, the ka, and the yad, you know, without that, without any Boston stuff.
I'm sorry.
Well, you know, like a non-Bostonian accents, eh? Or Midwestern accents, or anything like that. But it's like your typical standard American accent in this game. And I've always found that kind of funny in like movies. Like, there's this fucking sniper movie. It was like the Lone Sniper or something like that. It was back in 99. But the Russians all spoke with impeccable British accents, and everyone and the German officers that would talk spoke with American accents. I'm like, were you guys not able to spring for like anyone else from any part of the freaking country or any of the world that could at least fake a Russian accent? I thought that was fucking nuts. But yeah, anyway. Is that all you got to say about this Dishonored?
Besides play it? Yes.
Alright. Riley, we'll go ahead and end it with you, buddy. What's another favorite game of yours?
Another game.
He's so young, he probably hasn't played War.
Hush. don't be rude. Another game I really like is Sonic Colors.
I've never heard of that game.
So I'm a big fan of the Sonic the Hedgehog franchise, and I love most of the Sonic games I've played. I haven't played a lot of the ones that people are like, this is the horrible, bad one.
Wait, the movie just came out. How did they make games of it already?
Yeah, right? Did you guys hear there was a pinball game based on Sonic? It was on the Sega. Which, by the way, was one of my favorite freaking games. Anyway, go ahead. Boom! I got yes. Four in. Yes. Sorry. Go ahead, buddy.
Sonic Colors is a Wii game. Came out in like 2009. It's actually, even though it does have the sour note for me, is on the Wii.
Oh, Wii the console. I thought you meant it was like a small game, like a Wii game.
Like a Wii game. A wee dandy little noble of a game. Oh, da, 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 da.
Look at my wee game I got here.
Look at this wee little game.
So, it's a game, even though it has the sour note for me, that's actually the game that switched to the current voice actors. And I really like the voice Switch? Cast they had before. Robin, I swear to God.
Alright, I'm done.
Oh god, okay, so despite that, it's honestly like super refreshing. Like, it came after like what a lot of people consider the dark era of 3D Sonic games, where a lot of like mediocre to bad games come out. And it's like,
was this after 06?
This was after 06, yes.
Oh god, okay.
So
that's good perspective building.
You know, the poor bastards. Like, I feel
a breath of fresh air. It's basically the whole story of Colors is Sonic and Tails go to an alien planet because they find out that Eggman reportedly has gone good. He's a good guy now, and he made a space amusement park to pay for his misdeeds. But actually, of course, it was an evil plot, and he was stealing these little aliens full of energy called Wisps to power some sort of like weapon. And Sonic realizes that he can like fuse with these Wisps, and it gives them like powers. Like, there's a Wisp that can make him turn into a laser, there's a Wisp that can make him turn into a rocket, and like you use the Wisp powers throughout the game as part of the navigation of the levels. And there's also, you know, classic 3D Sonic run, boost, do the thing. And it's just like a really nice and colorful, obviously colorful game because it's literally called Sonic Colors. It's just nice and colorful, and the writing is really good. Like, it takes a more comedic tone than a lot of Sonic 3D Sonic games before it that are trying to be like way too serious. It's a more comedic game, and it plays those strengths really well. and I just really like Sonic Colors. It's my favorite in the Sonic franchise, and Sonic is one of the franchises that's closest to my heart, so that speaks a lot for Sonic Colors.
That's good. That's good, man. It's kind of crazy how many variations of Sonic the Hedgehog there are in the gaming world, and how there's still freaking games with that character that I've still never heard of them. That I'd never heard of, because I thought that I played all of them at one point in time, but it's nice to know that it's not always the case. Anyway, let's go ahead and wrap this up, guys. Let's do one more quick question. Robin, what's a game that you're really looking forward to coming out this year?
Fucking Animal Crossing New Horizon. Oh my god, that's the only game I care about.
I love how that game is competing with Doom for best meme, because it has like Doom guy ordering Animal Crossing and the Animal Crossing dog girl ordering a copy of Doom Eternal. And I love the shit out of that. So I'm hoping that both of those titles do extremely well. In fact, I'm pretty sure that both of them will. I gotta say, my game that I'm looking forward to coming out this year, or looking forward to, did Cyberpunk. I even say that right? Looking forward to coming out this year. It just sounds so weird in my head. Like, you know, when I'm doing those videos, like if you look at the most planning series that I'm doing, you know that like a portion of the time in those videos, I'm pointing out the literary and grammatical errors of the fucking people who are writing these articles. Like, that doesn't sound right. Like, I hate it when I have to do a take and they're like, for to do the thing. And like, that's poorly written. Why would you do that? Anyway, so I'm still hung up on that, I guess. But yeah, definitely Cyberpunk 2077. That's the game I'm looking forward to the most this year. Riley,
you better hope I show up for the MoCast when Animal Crossing comes out, because like, ooh.
Shit, man.
The cold open will be the whole episode, because it was talking about Animal Crossing and the cold open, and it'll be like 3 hours.
Like, oh my god, I talked to Phil today, and like, oh my god, he was so happy, and I went and I landscaped my whole village, and it looks really nice now, and I was building these ramps. Oh my god. Like, that's going to be every episode.
Oh, dear god. Riley, what's the game you're looking forward to this year?
A game I'm looking forward to this year is coming fairly soon, actually. Pokemon Mystery Dungeon Rescue Team DX is coming in March 6th.
You know, if I weren't so sure that was the name of that game, I think that you were just fucking with me and just adding extra shit in there. It was like the Turbo Street Fighter 2 Edition /3 Ex Machina to the second power. Like, I think you're just fucking with me.
That feels really good at.
Oh, there's a game that DSP's good at? Then the world really is ending.
He's good at a really bad port of Street Fighter 2.
Oh my god.
A console that nobody plays it on, and he won a tournament, and that's his call, that's his claim to fame.
So Mo, you are unversed in the Pokemon franchise. So Pokemon Mystery Dungeon is a series of spin-off games which takes the traditional monster collecting RPG and sort of throws it out the window. In Mystery Dungeon, you play as a Pokemon, and you have a Pokemon who's your
Mystery Dungeon Red and Blue were on the fucking Game Boy Color. I think he knows.
No, they weren't. They were on the Game Boy Advance.
Were they on a Game Boy Advance?
Yes.
No, they were before that, weren't they?
No, they were on the Game Boy Advance.
Oh, maybe they were. All right.
The Gen 3 starters were in Red and Blue Rescue Team.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, that's right, yeah. I don't like Red and Blue anyway. I like Sky.
Explorers,
yeah.
That's a fad that I really wish that I got into when I was a little bit younger. At least back in 99-2000 was. I wish I got into the handhelds. Like, I wish I got to play the Game Boy Advance. Well, yeah, I'm going to be doing that too. But there's... I always wanted
legally,
to...
by the way. Legally stream it to your Twitch channel. Buy the games and then stream it using a capture card for your
yeah, buy a GameCube and a Game Boy player and stream.
By emulate, I meant emulate like live stream.
Yeah, you know? Legally.
Sometimes.
But But yeah, that's one where I wish that I was able to actually participate in, you know, because it all, I like, whenever I would play the Game Boy, like, a lot of people sort of blow off the Game Boy like it's like a real nothing machine, but if you really think about it, many have tried to conquer the handheld market, but Nintendo is the only one that ever really stayed on top of anything. In fact, I don't think there really is anything that could knock off Nintendo at all on the top, at least in the handheld department. That's why I think the Switch is doing so well, is because it's sort of making a lot of the users, a lot of the players who grew up with handheld genre of video games and stuff. It seems that they're capitalizing on that, and I'm really, really happy for Nintendo, because if anyone deserves to be on top, it's Nintendo. Nintendo and PlayStation. Anyway, so, Riley, where can they find you at, man?
I wasn't done talking about Mystery Dungeon.
Well, we're at the 126 mark. Go ahead, just make it quick.
Okay, so you play as a Pokemon. It has a really good plot. It's a really good series, and they're remaking the first game, and it's super exciting. And that's why I'm super excited about it.
Nice, nice, nice. All right, so where can they find you, buddy?
They can find me on Twitter at RileyTweets, on Twitch at twitch.tv/RileyStreams. That's the one.
I love how you had to think about that for a second.
You made it.
But, you know, for real, I did get to see your stream last night when you were playing The Sims 4, and I had a really good time. Even after I lurked you and went somewhere else for a little bit, I came back off and on watching your stuff. But, that's it. That's all.
Yeah, I finally courted Nina Valiente. That was the quest for these two streams, this random, the first 5 minutes of me playing, this random redheaded girl knocked on my door and came into my house, and I proceeded to use my character to like endlessly harass her until she finally dated me at the end of this last stream.
that's so like mundane. It's fucking crazy that the fucking Sims. It's crazy how the Sims have like progressed and have stayed on top of things since like since the late 90s. But anyway, so Robin, where can they find you at?
Damn.
They can find me on Twitter at InsideAlloy. They can also find me on Twitch when I stream again in the future one day. Twitch.tv/InsideAlloy.
Uh-huh.
That's it. That's all my things.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm a little bit of breaking news here. I heard that we forgot Riley's Twitter account. So Riley, what was your Twitter account?
My Twitter account was Riley Tweets.
At Riley Tweets on Twitter.com.
Yes, on Twitter.com at Riley Tweets. You also cut me off before I can plug my podcast feed that I always plug.
Oh, I thought Pixels
and Polygons. Wow.
Yeah.
Well, that one's cool and all. That one's cool and all. Pokemon Variety Hour, blah, blah, blah. But the real one you got to be concerned about.
The
Riley Podcast. The Riley Podcast. Well, yeah, of course the Dickheads Podcast. But more importantly, the Riley Podcast mega feed can be found on Stitcher or Spotify. It's the home of many great podcasts, like Largest Issue in the Galaxy, which Mo was on last time.
Yes, I was. And I recently guest hosted on your podcast. I had a ton of fun. It was great.
Go check out the description. Yeah. The link will be down there.
Oh, yeah. This is all be in the description, by the way, everyone. So is that...
Go listen to the Largest Issue, Largest Momo in the Momo. See?
Oh, yes. Yeah, and I already had someone say in your Discord, I'd ship it, referring to the both of us. So I'm already flattered that your community has already taken me in and already made...
He's been on the show before. He came on the cop episode.
He's already made weird sex jokes toward my person. Well, anyway, you can find me at HappyGoodBoy420 on Twitter.com, MoDiggity42 on Instagram, YouTube.com/C/MoDiggity42 on YouTube, and Twitch.tv/MoDiggity. You can find me all on there, and all the links will be in the description. So, from me, from Robin, from Riley, and everyone else involved in the MoCast, I say thanks for coming out. I appreciate it. Thank you for listening, and ta-ta.
Bye.